Hey, once again, it's your boy Mac357. This is the Evening Experience Radio Show from 5 to 7 every Thursday. It's going down. We're getting ready to do it live. Waiting for people to come into the room. I just want to say, what's up, Dirty Boots? What's popping? Once again, it's your boy Mac357. All the people that are coming in, I appreciate y'all coming in. Share it out. Let everybody know that we're here. Andrea, what's up? We're getting ready to do our show today, 5 to 7 p.m. every Thursday. It goes down right here on the Instagram page for the Evening Experience. For everybody that's piling in, first and foremost, I'd like to give my condolences to a couple of families. God rest the soul of Fred the Godson. God rest the soul of Soulful Journey. Once again, God rest the soul for both of those brothers. Renan Amika, what up? What's popping? Everybody that's piling in, DigiWax, what's up? Once again, God rest the soul of Fred the Godson. God bless his family. My deepest condolences. King James Worthy is in the building already. All right, King James Worthy is in the building already. We're going to start off with him as a guest. And then we're going to go from there. All right, we're going to get ready to go live with King James Worthy. What's up, sir?
What's up, man?
What's popping?
Oh, man, nothing but the work.
This is the Evening Experience Radio Show from 5 to 7 every Thursday. Normally, it's not in here. It's normally I'm in the studio. But at this moment, because of COVID, we are definitely doing the thing in the house.
Much love.
Once again, my deepest condolences to Fred the Godson's family.
Condolences, RIP to Fred the Godson.
To all the people who are suffering from this virus, for all the people who are dealing with illnesses and you know, death, God bless you all. I'm sorry that you're dealing with this.
Absolutely.
But Mr. James Worthy's in the building now. I'm gonna start off with the process that you are platinum. You have platinum awards and gold awards.
I do.
For your works or stuff that you've written for other people?
A lot of it, for a lot of different reasons, production, songwriting, synth licensing, a lot of my own music, a lot of blessings.
Okay. How did it feel receiving those accolades, from, the work that you put in? If you can explain that feeling of elation, dealing with the process of making music and then having someone wanting to say, hey, because you've sold this many albums or because this many albums were sold, here's something that you can now hang on your wall.
Man, I can't even explain how much of a blessing it is because, you know, when you're in a competitive business and everybody does the same thing that you're doing and, you know, everybody's trying to get to the next level, it can be hard, it can be frustrating, it can be all kind of different things. So for me, I've always had a strong mind, but, you know, you always have to keep that positive energy around you and that motivation to keep going. And that's what I've had. I always try to keep positive energy around me because anything can take you off the deep end, you know what I mean? Or just derail you from what the goal is. And for me, I just always had a goal.
Okay. So with you having a goal, now that you've reached some of the accolades of the industry itself, what's the plan now? What's the biggest push going forward?
The biggest push. Just really continuing to build the brand, continuing to be consistent in not only song making, but in business. You know what I mean? We're in a very interesting time right now to where everything is fully based off of the internet right now. So everybody has eyes in different areas on the internet. So you have to figure out ways to create income and create business opportunities that maybe you haven't tapped in before. So, you know, just really focusing on that and continuing to touch different audiences and fans and people in different places of the world.
And it is a definitely a unique time. And I'm telling a lot of artists and people that you have a captive audience. If you haven't had a process where you facilitated to go into social media, and I mean really go in, with the process of making sure that those people who are sitting at home know who you are, to build upon your brand as far as getting your music out there, whether it's through streaming, purchase, or whatever the case may be, this is a momentum that you can start. So when now you're going back out on the circuit, whether it's a Chitlin circuit or you're actually a mainstream or you open up the act, that they know that they're going to come and see you because they know what you're doing.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Because I think the business in of itself is changed in the sense that you younger guys, God bless y'all, a lot easier making a name than it was back in the day. Back in the day, you can go to Hot 97, Power 105, 98.7, you know, WBLS, and had to go through like a gauntlet just to get in the door. And the work, the amount of work that you had to put in, the number of hours, are now spent on social media as opposed to the process of you having to go and do it the way in which they did it back in the day.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, the game has changed. You know, I was fortunate enough to, you know, come up, you know, back in the day with, you know, legendary artists and have that that wisdom and those different experiences behind me to, you know, not only learn, but incorporate that into my own business and know what not to do, what to do. And you know, a lot of people still don't realize that, you know, hand-in-hand contact and, you know, and we can't right now. But, you know, in a business sense, you know, direct-to-consumer is very, very still alive. You know what I mean? And I think people forget that because everything is so digital nowadays. And people just think, oh, you know, I can stream or buy your music online. But, you know, it still makes a difference when you're putting something in someone's hand. You know, it makes it a different ball game.
So with that being the case, what is James Worthy's plan to attack the market?
Well, right now, what has really, really helped me is I've always respected artists in every genre. That's number one. So even me coming into the game very young, I came into the industry at 11 years old. And within me doing that and continuing to grow as a musician, I've always delved in every genre. So I've done production in pop, EDM, jazz, dance, trap music, rap music, R&B. So whatever it is, I've had my hands in it. So it's given me so much leverage to do what I want to do, number one. But also, too, I've incorporated that in my own music to where I can collaborate with newer artists and older artists, in which I've already done. So I don't want to say that's a lost art, but it's not a lot of artists that's doing that or is able to do that because they haven't had the experience to do it. So that's what sets me apart. And you know, I'm just a music lover, so I respect those who've came before me. And you know, I've had the pleasure of working with artists that I've grown up listening to and who are part of my musical journey, and actually having, you know, a blessed opportunity to have a record with them, which is amazing as well.
Yeah, for me, the process is, and I tell people this all the time, you know, I hear kids all the time, When I say kids, anybody who's 20 years younger than me is a kid. I say to them all the time when they go, "Oh, that's old school." No, music is timeless.
Yeah,
it's like wine. It may come from a certain age, but it doesn't make it any less powerful with
right.
what was being put forth and the sound and the lyrics and things that make it, you know, jive with the person that's accepting it or
exactly.
How did you first, or when was the first time you pinned your actual, when you first started to write? What was the first thing that you wrote about in a song that you can remember to this day?
The first thing.
Don't mind me. These are real questions because this is a real question.
Right. No, I love it. It was probably something along the lines of me liking a young lady at the time and, hey, you know, do you want to go out or something like that? It was something real stupid and cheesy, you know. Hey. But, you know, hey, you know, it's I had to put the feelings in the song, you know.
That's right.
Yeah.
The reason why I said that is because of the fact that, you know, when people are putting things together musically, you know, there's something that drives them.
Yeah.
So now what drives your music? Like, what gives it its life? What gives it its purpose? Where do you get your inspirations from?
I mean, just the key word, life, you know, experiences, things that, you know, I go through, maybe on a personal level or a business level, you know, everything has lessons in it. Everything has experiences in it. So, you know, I just kind of take those things and put them in a pot and form the content and form, you know, the ideas of, okay, this is what I want to talk about in this particular song. You know, maybe I've went through this particular thing and I need to express it in song format. You know, so many different things, especially now, you know, in this time that we're in, is so much to talk about and so much to express. So right now is really no excuse.
What's one of your tracks that we can play off of YouTube?
It's tons of them. I have a brand new one that I just released 2 days ago entitled Do You Know? So it's basically just a short song, just kind of referencing, you know, someone who is trying to express to their significant other that, you know, of course they love them, but they're letting them know what they can bring to the table. And, you know, just letting things be known. That's it.
Okay. Well, as I'm getting ready to try to pull this up.
And what's going on, everybody tuning in? How you doing?
It's about what? About 2 minutes long?
Yes. Yeah, that's it.
Now, there's a red version, Will R&B.
Yeah, that's another YouTuber that posted it. Same record.
Okay. So I'm about to play it right now. Once again, this is James Worthy that's currently right here.
What's up?
Is Do You Know? Once again, this is Mac 357. This is the Evening Experience. Let's go.
Hold on. Do you know? Do you know? Without you, yeah. Can I make a way? Can I make a way?
Yeah. All right, people, that was Do You Know by the one and only James Worthy.
Yeah.
Now, let me know, first and foremost, where did Do You Know come from?
Do You Know, actually, I had that record for about 2 years now. I had it since 2018, and I really didn't know what to do with it at first. It was just something that I was messing around with. It was a different version at the time, so I kind of changed it up. But it was definitely just something, you know, I was dealing with a certain person at the time, and it was something I wanted to write about. You know,
all right.
You know, I had to let the feelings out.
Well, my mind is one that when I hear certain things lyric wise, or certain things, and I know writers get inspirations either from people that they've encountered, like friends of theirs going through something, or something personal. And when I'm listening to the lyrics and I'm listening to the melody, I'm like, that sounds like something he's been through.
Yeah, definitely.
Well, currently I'm from Mount Vernon, New York. Mr. Worthy is where?
Queens, New York.
He's in Queens, New York. Okay, so Mount Vernon, home of Heavy D, God rest his soul.
Yes, sir.
AKA Dwight Myers. Listen, I can go on. Jeff Redd. We have had Felisa Rashad, Debbie Allen that lived in Mount Vernon. To Mount Vernon High School. And if you, I'm going way back now, Art Carney. When I say that, and I'm talking about, we're talking about the Honeymooners, and that's us.
Oh yeah, you're going way back.
And then Dick Clark went to Mount Vernon High School.
Mm-hmm.
But with that being the case, going forward in 2020, once COVID, you know, somebody made a joke. I think it was DJ Self, not making a joke, but I think he just took a joke and is, you know, like reposted it.
Yeah.
And he says, wait till the golf courses and the country clubs open up, then you know it's safe.
Right. I mean, you know, like I said, we're in a crazy time right now. So, you know, we got to be safe. We got to be smart, you know what I mean? And not be selfish either. You know, I see a lot of people who are just not taking it serious. And
nope. They
never know what they're having right now. You can have no symptoms and still have it and infect other people. So be wise about that, y'all. Shout out to Big Jig. What's up, man?
All the people who are tuning in.
Everybody, man. I see your notes.
Worthy.
But yeah, man, you know, I really advise everybody, man, to take this seriously, be safe, and, you know, just stay home right now. Just stay quarantined, stay safe, and we'll get through it.
So what's the rest of your 2020 going to look like if and when everything opens up? Like, are you planning a tour? Are you planning to
do
an album?
Yeah, absolutely. This year we were planning the tour. But of course, this thing happened, so we pushed it back. But there will be a James Worthy tour coming up soon. New music videos on the way, you know, new content on the way. In the midst of that, working on my debut album as well. So just staying busy, staying consistent.
Now, are there any artists that you have written for that you could tell us that you have wrote or penned the song?
Yeah. Man, I've done stuff with Whitney Houston, Bobby Brown, Fetty Wap, Truth Hurts, Dr. Dre, Future, Yo Gotti, Robinette, CeCe Peniston, Arrested Development. I mean, the list goes on. Justin Bieber.
He's just naming a few names. People you might know.
You know, just a couple of them.
Just a couple. Bruh, to write for the likes of Whitney, Dr. Dre alone is incredible.
Yeah.
You know, you know, Dre is very particular with who he works with.
Yeah. Shout out to Dr. Dre. Shout out to my sister Truth Hurts as well. If you guys know who Truth Hurts is, she was the first lady on Aftermath.
Yes, sir.
That's like my big sister. She's actually on my last EP, Kaleidoscopes, in which, speaking of that, we have a brand new music video called This Wave that we are releasing next month. So myself and Truth Hurts, you'll see her in the video with me. So Yeah, it's gonna be crazy.
And Tell Truth Hurts, there is a show that she can come on, you know, the evening is, yeah, it's crazy.
Absolutely, absolutely. We can premiere the video on here.
Bruh, listen, you ain't saying nothing but a word.
Let's do it.
Tell everybody where they can find you on social media besides King James Worthy.
Yeah, so all social media platforms, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, at King James Worthy. You can also go to the website, kingjamesworthy.com. And you can also stream all music on all platforms, Spotify, Tidal, Apple Music, Google Play, Amazon, anywhere you can buy stream music. Every project is there. Blue Leisure, Kaleidoscopes, Do You Know, all my singles, all my projects is all available. So make sure you go get a copy of all that stuff and make sure you follow me and just follow the journey.
So this incredible artist himself is currently putting out incredible works.
Thank you.
Accolades for it. Doing stellar things in the music industry. Look out for greatness. Always, if you're looking for someone to produce for you, he's there. If you're looking for someone to pen that music for you, he's there.
Let's do it.
Just make sure you look out for the multifaceted, the multi-talented King James Worthy. And I've been a guest today, sir.
Thank you so much for having me, man. Be easy.
Hey.
Peace.
All right. That was King James Worthy. We're going to get the next guest in here. It's the one and only Mr. Hawthorne James. Now let's see if we're copacetic and everything is working the way it's supposed to. Mr. James is in. Hey! How are you, sir?
I'm good. How about yourself?
All right. Now, first and foremost, this is the honorable gentleman that I would want to say is taking time out of his busy schedule to be on this show today. We appreciate the one and only Mr. Hawthorne James, actor of stage and film. He is a professor. He is an incredible person who's took time out of his busy schedule to actually speak with us today.
It's my pleasure to be here. And schedule is not so busy today. I ain't been so busy in the last month, man. What are you talking about? Had my butt right here at home.
Yes, sir.
But it's great to be here anyway. I mean, I would take my schedule and figure out a way that we could talk anyway, no matter what.
Now, with that being the case, you are best known for, and I know I've seen pictures, many pictures, but now because I'm a little bit older than some of my audience. From you way back in the day. I've watched when I was a kid myself, because I was born in 73. And I want to say that you have been an illustrious staple in the acting community for many years, and I appreciate the works that you've put out.
I appreciate you saying that very much. I take a lot of pride in my work, man.
And a lot of people don't know this, that you actually are a professor at a university and you teach.
Yeah, well, I don't teach so much now. See, all my degrees are in theater. I have a bachelor's from Notre Dame. I have a master's from the University of Michigan. I got scholarship offers from Yale and Cornell. And Ted Lange, who was the bartender in The Love Boat.
Yes.
Teddy got me a scholarship to study in London at the London Shakespeare Academy. But in between all of that, I did teach. I was a university professor for 2 years at Illinois State University. So, yeah, you name it, I've done it in the industry. Because at one point, I was one of the highest Black executives in Hollywood. That was my last 9-to-5 job. I left TriStar in 1986 and never look back.
So you used to work for TriStar Media itself?
Yeah, TriStar Pictures, yes.
Wow.
I was the head of the post-production ancillary markets. So like I say, at that time, I was one of the highest Black executive, if not the highest Black executive in Hollywood.
You start in, and I'm just going to go down a little bit of the list. Disco Godfather, and you played in Penitentiary 2. You played in Color Purple. You played in the movie Patty Hearst. I'm Gonna Get You Sucker, which was one of my favorites. You played in the movie Ricky 1. You played Othello, which is an incredible, if you don't know, it's part of Shakespeare.
And that was a film that Ted Lange produced, and he played Othello. And I got to play Iago, the greatest villain that Shakespeare has ever written. And it's on film, it's on celluloid, never will go away. And that's one of the greatest things, one of the greatest roles you could ever accomplish.
You played in The Doors.
Uh-huh. Yep.
Of course, the famed The Five Heartbeats, which is iconic film that will... once again, I will tell people will never be without, you know, people watching it, because it's an incredible film. And when I say that, your line, my office hours are 9 to 5, will always be one of the best parts of that movie. Now, and he's been in Frasier. He's been in Carolina Midnight. He's been in Speed, the movie 7, Heaven's Prisoners. And I can go on and on. And currently there's a role that you're currently in, which was done by a young lady who happened to be, I think, 13 or 14 years old. And her mom wrote the movie called Why Me?
The young lady... 13 years old when she wrote it. Young black girl, 13 years old. She wrote it with the help of her mother, but she's the one. It's a film about mental health. And she wrote it because of the fact that she noticed that one of her classmates was suffering from something, and it wound up being mental health. And so she wrote this film. This is an incredible young lady. I ain't even gonna lie. The movie's called Why Me? And Robert Parham directed the movie. And when we got down there, of course, because her mother and her are not screenwriters, there were some adjustments that had to be made in the script, but the script itself is essentially the same. We made our own little contributions. And Cinda Williams, who was in Mo' Better Blues and played Halle Berry's sister in the Dorothy Dandridge story, she plays my wife in the film. And it really is. I'm excited about this film. And I haven't been excited about a film in a long time. And this one, I'm very happy that I did. You know, it's low budget, but you can't tell. It doesn't matter. It's just a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful experience that I had working with. And we did it down in Memphis. And the people that I met in Memphis, the people who put money into the film, et cetera, I can't say enough about those people.
Now, my question to you is, in the process of you getting into film, what gave you the gumption, or the if you want to say, process for wanting to choose the arts as your process for making a living? Like, what was the first thing that you saw or did that made you go, wow, this is what I really want to do?
Well, see, the process itself took a long time, I think, because I remember, I'm a middle kid, I'm number 4 of 8, and my older brothers and sisters were extremely popular in school, and I was born and raised in Chicago, and I went to Catholic school, and those nuns really liked my older brothers and sisters, so here I come along. And they were not, man, who cares about another one, you know? So I remember very distinctly when I was about 5 or 6 years old, there's a sister, there's a nun named Sister Aquanette who did a kindergarten play every year. And I was in the play, and I got on stage, and all I did was go around in a circle, going, woo! But in my mind, I said, number one, I'm going to be the best at people watching me and paying attention to me. So I really believe that's where it started. And then, you know, you go along. I did a priest would do, either, every year he would do one play. He would do either do Raisin in the Sun or he would do Hamlet. Well, my freshman year, they did Raisin in the Sun, and I wasn't able to do it because they didn't use freshmen. But my sophomore year, I got to be in Hamlet. And I just played one of the guards. And apparently, I mumbled as a kid because I remember my mother telling this story. She came to see the play, my mother, and said, "Is that James Herbert?" Mm-hmm. Because they finally understood me. When I hit that stage, it became crystal clear. Something happened, something magical happened. And then we moved to, from Chicago to Michigan my last 3 years of high school to a small town, Vandalia, and I went to high school in Cassopolis. And I did a play in Cass. And right before I went out on stage, a girl that I was really, really, really liked, she came up and she kissed me. And I went out on that stage and I immediately forgot every line that I had. But it took a few minutes for me to get it back. But I finally got it back. But to this day, I don't allow any woman to kiss me when I go out on stage. It's a superstition of mine. But those little things, and then when you go to college, you know, you're trying to figure out the major, and, you know, I went through art, I went through English, I went through music as majors, and then I finally realized, this is stupid, I know what I want. And I went into the theater department and never looked back, not knowing that I could make a living out of it, you know what I mean? I mean, maybe teaching in high school or teaching in college. Then I went to grad school, and then I got a job teaching, like I say, at Illinois State. And then after 2 years there, I realized teaching in the university sucks because there's too much politics. And I knew that's not what I wanted to do anyway. And we had a huge department, and none of the professors in my department had ever done anything professionally, not one thing. And I thought to myself, how the hell can I be teaching kids how to be professionals? And I've never done it. So I had a girlfriend who I've been dating, and she had to do her summer internship because she was a Parks and Rec major. She moved to California, and I decided to either go to New York or California. And I said, it's cold in New York, number one. All my friends went to New York. I'd rather go to Cali. And my reasoning was, if I make it in New York, nobody in Cali will know you. But if you make it in Cali, everybody in New York will know you. That's the way the industry works. So I just packed up my bags and moved to Cali, moved in with her. That didn't last long, but I had a place to stay at least. And that's the genesis of it. And then I started doing a lot of theater in LA. There was a place called the Inner City Cultural Center. See, Bernard Jackson ran it, and it was the best thing that ever happened because I would be rehearsing two plays and being and performing in one at night. And, you know, and still having to work the 9-to-5 job because you got to eat, got to pay the rent, got to pay the phone bill. But it was constant. And I started meeting people. And the first film I did was Disco Godfather. It's a Rudy Ray Moore film. And I got to be in that film because of the fact that the guy who was directing and producing a lot of theater that I was in pulled me along and said, here, he gave me my first role, my first leading role, as a matter of fact, as the lead bad guy in Disco Godfather. And then I got, that was a non-union movie. And then I got my union, became union eligible through Penitentiary 2. But my first full union movie was The Color Purple.
Wow.
And, you know, I'm going to tell you a story about this one too. I hope I'm not rambling this on, but it's just one thing leads to another sometimes. I was still at TriStar at that time. And there was this white secretary, and she told me, here, you need to read this book. And she had it on her desk, and it was The Color Purple. So I picked up the book and I read like 2-3 pages of it. I threw it back on her desk. I hate this shit. And so Teddy was sponsoring through the Inner City Cultural Center an acting competition, which I won that year. And Ruben Cannon was the casting director for The Color Purple. He was a judge at the finals.
Wow.
So he called me in to audition for The Color Purple. Well, honest to God, this is This is the truth. I went in there because I hated that book so much. Just the 2-3 pages I read. I tried to be bad. Well, lo and behold, 2 weeks later, my agent calls and said, Steven Spielberg saw the tape. He wants you to come back and do audition again for the call. So I went back, and honestly, I tried to be worse because I didn't want to do it. Well, this is what God says to you. Look here, knucklehead. I'm trying to give you a job, you stupid. You dummy. Of course, I got the job. I worked a week, made a lot of money in that week, made more money than I've ever made in my life. And after 86, that's when I left TriStar, there would be times when I would go and I would say, how am I going to pay my rent? I have no money. I'm broke. I would go to the mailbox and there would be a residual check from The Color Purple. So no matter what you do, there's a reason. There's a reason that you're in this world. And you have to figure it out, which led me to becoming who I am today. Because the greatest thinkers in the world were at inner city. Sheep and I Jackson would pull in some of the greatest minds, and we would go after rehearsal, we would go to a place called the Stockyard, and we would sit there and we would listen to these minds. And they would talk about the world. And I knew, me myself, there was a consciousness about who we are as Black people, and who I am already formulated. But listening to those people, it started to really get there and understand how important the arts are. Because you have to understand, everybody from around the world thinks they know who you are through film, television, media, books. That's why Koreans, that's why Taiwanese, that's why Chinese, Japanese, Polish come over here, open a business in your neighborhood and treat you like dirt, because that's what they've seen on that film and television, that propaganda. And that's my mission in life. Now, I've been in films and television. Doesn't mean anything to me anymore. What means something to me now is films like Why Me? There's another film that I did, this brother in North Carolina who spent 17 and a half years in he was initially gave him life. And he got out after 17 and a half years. And he wrote a book, and he did a film based on his book called A Polished Soul, about his life and how he turned his life around. And I'm in that film. That's another one of those films I can't wait to see. Because those things mean something to me. And my philosophy is, I was talking to someone yesterday. I think it was on an interview yesterday. And my whole life, and I mean this, I don't be free till you be free. It doesn't matter to me how much fame and fortune, because you have to remember, I'm still a Black man in America.
Amen.
And it doesn't matter. I've been stopped by the police in the last 3 years twice. It doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter how much success you have. You're still a Black man in America. And I care about every Black person in this country. And my contribution, my art, is to figure out how I can make my art reflect who we are. Because we have to stop. It doesn't matter about the money. I'm tired of people talking about money. I'm tired of people worried, being afraid. We can't afford to be afraid. Look at what they're doing now. In Georgia, they're opening up nail salons, barbershops, bowling alleys. And I was listening to the interview you said that you had right before that. Who frequents those businesses? They're not opening up the golf clubs and the country clubs.
Right.
They're using you as a guinea pig. And that has to be reflected in my art, so that I can awaken other people. I saw a picture today which was disgusting. There was a picture on my Facebook page of Black women, 10 to 12, waiting outside the nail salon for it to open. That's disgusting. How ignorant is that? Because they don't know. They're not aware. They've not been made to think. We have to think. Well, we have to start thinking and not be afraid. You're going to make some money. You know, Denzel ain't making Tom Cruise money and never will to make Tom Cruise money. Sam Jackson ain't making, you know, the top dollars. I mean, he works all the time. But you have to understand, they're in a whole different stratosphere. We can't go hat in hand every time. Please, sir, can I have a little bit of what you got? And then fight each other for what they throw on the floor. That's why I love, that's why I said to you in the beginning, no matter what, you said, taking my time out of this, and even though I don't have anything to do, I will still take my time out for you because I want to support you as a Black man who's doing the right thing.
I appreciate that.
Well, and it doesn't matter.
I like that because my mother raised me right. She said, anybody does anything for you, you know, be thankful, be humble, because there's people who are in this industry that I've talked to, and I tell everybody this all the time. You have a start. You start someplace. But mm-hmm. people, too, as they go rising up, forget where they came from. Instead of saying, I'm a superstar, why should I waste my time on your show? Be glad that somebody remembers you. Because now mm-hmm. in this time, everybody's on an equal playing field. And they Absolutely. Don't understand that to keep their footing, you got people who that would never connect with you, now connecting with you again because of the fact that these people are now sitting home like everybody else, and they're going to forget who I am. Let me go online. Hey, I'm here. Okay, what's up? How you doing? All right, mm-hmm. let's talk to a few people. And not understanding that before this, those same people were there. And you need mm-hmm. to understand, you need to align with these people who basically give you your salaries, make you your money. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, we know that the studio pays you at the time, and then they hope to make the money back through mm-hmm. box office and other sales, whether it's television, whether it's Netflix, whether it's Hulu, whether it's whatever. But the fact is, people don't understand that until something like this happened. Mm-hmm. So for me, I'm a person that, listen, if a person has a great concept and a great show and does something powerful, I'm not saying go on everybody's show, but hey, if somebody is of character and can articulate and can have a great dialogue with that person, take the time out. You never know who you're going to meet. You never know who they know. You never know what they can do as far as building you as a person. Because sometimes people get caught into a bubble and they forget who they are because of what they've achieved. And mm-hmm. I understand that you had a mother and father who raised you a certain way, but sometimes you forget that when you reach a certain plateau, mm-hmm. all of those things fall away from you and you forget. And that's how they get caught up in Hollywood and start using drugs and drinking and all those other curses. But don't mind me, I'm on my soapbox.
No, that's all good, because what you're saying is absolutely true. Because that's one of those things where I had a family who kept me grounded because of the fact that I still had, when I went home in Michigan, I still had to take the garbage out.
That's up.
You know, it doesn't matter. And I know this. And I think I'm going to entitle my book when I write it, I'm Still That Kid. Because in my mind, I'm still that kid from the south side of Chicago who didn't have enough to eat. Mm. So when people come up to me and ask me for an autograph, when they come up to me, ask me to take a picture with me, when they come up and say what my work has done, added to their lives, it's like, wow. Wow, you want to take a picture with me? As a child, that never even entered into my mind. That's not what I got into this business for. I got into this business because I happen to love what I do. I happen to love being on stage. When I'm on stage, I come alive. And it doesn't matter how much money you make. I mean, most of the theater I've done over 300 plays. And 90% of it, I didn't get a dime, not even gas money. I had to work and do plays at night. So, but it doesn't matter, because once I hit that stage or walk onto a set, if I'm making $5 or $100,000, it doesn't matter to me. It's all the same. You have to remember, and especially, see, I'm very grateful for Black people, because without Black folks, I wouldn't be sitting there, I wouldn't be talking to you right now. Because I could have gone to law school. I actually got accepted into law school. And I said, and I would go to my friends' houses that were in law school, and they would be sitting in the dark, and they'd have laundry up to the ceiling, dirty laundry, and they'd be sitting there reading Torch. And if you know what Torch is a book about this thick. And I'd walk in the house and I looked at it and say, oh, hell no. And I said, no, that's not what I want to do with my life. But Black folks, I mean, I go back to the fact that my life has been a roller coaster, because sometimes you have a few bucks and a lot of times you don't. I mean, 6-7 years ago, I was almost homeless. Because not through fault of my own, I'm not living an extravagant life. I don't spend my money like that. I've got the same apartment that I had when I first moved to LA with that girl. I kept it. I moved all around the city, but for some reason I kept that apartment. And honest to God, that apartment cost me $500 a month. But there came a point, something happened, and I wasn't able to, I was almost broke. And my girlfriend, a friend of mine who is now my girl here in Vegas, I called her out of desperation. I said, look here, I don't have any money. Can you pay my phone bill? She, without hesitation, said, oh. She paid my phone bill for the next 4 or 5 months. My brothers, I've got a couple of brothers who gave me money. I got a friend in LA named James Burks who would pick me up, who would take me out. He would pay for everything, you know, just so I wasn't stuck in the house, et cetera, et cetera. And it's like I would go to the gas station, pull it in my pocket, and I would pull out, trying to figure out how much money I had to put in the gas tank. I'd be counting pennies, 50, 60, 70, a dollar and a quarter. And some homeless person would walk up to me and say, yo, bro, really like your work. Keep it up. You represent. And they would walk away. Now, I've been sitting there thinking, why am I doing this? I could have gone to law school. And then they walk up and say what they say and leave. And I say, okay, I can go on for another day. That's what Black people did for me. And so I say thank you to Black people all the time, because you're the ones that supported me. You're the ones that come up to me and say, you are worthy. We remember you. People ask me all the time, don't you get tired of people coming up talking about your office hours? No, never have I not once gotten tired of that. That is a blessing. For people to actually remember something that you did from 25 years ago, and to this day, it's like that film came out yesterday. Like it came out yesterday. 5 and 6 year old kids know that film come up to me. Because wow. Their aunts, their uncles, their grandmother watch it every day, so the kids sit there and watch it. So no, what a blessing, man. I'm living a very blessed life, frustrated as I can be, but I got support, and I'm damn good at what I do, and I know it.
and on top of the fact that you are an illustrious actor who've done so much for our communities and have probably spearhead so many actors who wanted to follow in your footsteps, seeing you intricately in a lot of movies and listening to your greatness that you bring forth. And I believe in giving flowers while people are alive. You are an outstanding and an incredible actor who's spearhead a lot of different people just because of the fact that you played roles and you facilitated to give them the best parts of that character in which you played. You know, I respect everything that you just said, because, you know, as a young lady said, Miss Sunshine DA1 said, she said, you know, you don't get the realness sometimes of the real side of what goes on in Hollywood or goes on in this world, because everybody, as you said, are always trying to put on airs like, yeah, I'm, you know, such and such and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And don't give you the realness of what this industry is. And, you know, sometimes some of the things that you fall into or pitfalls that may befall you because of the fact that, you know, you had to go through something in order to come out on the other side. Or you're building your career, you know, you're starting off and you don't have everything in place. You know, nobody's, when you walk in Hollywood, given a silver spoon. I had a young man on here, Ron Rico Lee, who said, I was in, you know, the Sister TV show, but I was still taking a bus to work. He said, I was getting dropped off right in front of Paramount Studios by the bus. And people were like, I knew that was him. But he said he had to go through that process until he said, now I'm, you know, stable and I got everything I need and, you know, I have a nice house or whatever the case is. But he said it was time invested and things that I had to utilize in order to make this process happen. What is one of the most memorable roles that you went out for? And what is one of the most, one of the movies that you passed on that was like mega?
Oh, man. Okay, let me get the passed on first. There's two of them. One is what is the name of that film? Where the prisoners on the airplane. What?
It was Airplane. With you talking about
No. This was the prisoners were on the airplane. They filmed in Vegas, and the prisoners, and what's that guy's name? He's Francis Ford Coppola's nephew. They were on the airplane, their plane crashes, they hijacked the plane, and I can't think of the name of the movie. It'll come back to me. With no audition or nothing, my agent called and said the director saw your face and he wants to use you.
They just put it out.
Con Air. Thank you. Con Air. So they said the director saw you. He wants to use you. Well, I had done a play with Ving Rhames, and I've known Ving for a long time. I was in his first big film, The Patty Hearst Story, and that's another story unto itself. But Ving was in the film. I was younger than John Malkovich, but he was in my class in college. I taught John Malkovich. That's a whole different story. That's a long story unto itself. So he was in the film, and then Dave Chappelle, of course, and all it would be a glorified extra. And I thought to myself, I told my agent, look, I'm trying to build a career here. And I can't be doing things like that. And to watch Ving get to work and watch Dave Chappelle get to work, and I'm sitting there just a face, I couldn't handle it, I don't think. So I turned it down. Now, my friends, I've got other friends who were in the film, and they built swimming pools and stuff, because this was back in the 90s when they were just pumping out money like crazy. They were flying people back and forth in private planes, et cetera. And so the only reason I regret not having done it is because maybe I could have bought me some. So I did that. That's Con Air, one of those films I turned down. And then Gone in 60 Seconds, it was there's a white guy who did the role. He didn't speak until the end. And the director wanted me to come in because they wanted me for that. And I said no, because there were no lines. And that was silly because, I mean, you can do something with a character with no lines, but you don't know those things at that time. So those were the two things that I actually turned down that were huge hits. I actually turned down Speed. See, this is once again God saying, shut up, ignoramus. Because I turned down Speed because when I read the script, I said, this is stupid. this is really stupid. I mean, a bomb on the bus, blah, blah, blah. So I turned it down. They came back and said, we'll give him more money, blah, blah, blah. And finally I said yes. And I'm gonna tell you something, I don't say this. Trying to say some things for the book. But this is Hollywood for you. When I turned it down, I turned it down twice. They came back, they said more money, et cetera, et cetera. And then something else they said that they did. So I turned it down twice. And finally they came back and my agent, this is what my agent told me. This is exact words, and I've never forgotten this. She said, the producer got on the line with her and said, what is his problem? He's getting the same amount of money as the white woman.
Wow.
And he wasn't talking about Sandra Bullock. He was talking about one of the other passengers on the bus.
Wow.
That's Hollywood for you. That's Hollywood, man. They think that a black man should be happy that he's getting the same amount of money as a white woman.
Wow.
These are the things you have to navigate. I turned down seven. And I only turned down once because what they came back with was, of course, we'll give you more money, we'll put your name up front. And by the way, do you know he'll be working with Morgan Freeman? Well, that was the capper. Of course, more money, my name up front. So that was okay, we'll do it. But when I said working with Morgan Freeman, and I wanted to work with Morgan Freeman because he has something that I don't have. My background was in theater. And in theater, you have to be a little bigger because you have to reach the, as they say, the little blind deaf lady in the third balcony in the last row. So all my life, I've tended to be a little big in what I do. In the camera, you pull it all in. You have to prepare the same. There's the same internal preparation, but you don't have to have big gestures. It takes away. Morgan Freeman has that stillness. If you watch his work, he's very still. And so I wanted to see that up close and personal, to observe how do you be still like that and yet convey what you need to convey. And to this day, I'm still working on it. But that's one of those things that I love to do. I'm constantly working at my craft. That's one of those things.
All right.
But
I wanted
but,
to
this okay, I'm sorry.
Right, no, this incredible person that you're looking at right now currently is Mr. Hawthorne James, the incredible, incredible person that is currently sitting here with us on the Evening Experience radio show from 5 to 7 every Thursday. Says I got about a minute and a half left, so if I lose you right now, I'm going to come right back just to let you know. But I'm going to end this right now, and I'm going to come back in 2 seconds.
Okay.
All right, so we'll be right back momentarily. This is the Evening Experience radio show. 5 to 7 every Thursday is going down. We're coming right back. Fluff Jones TV, I'm glad you're on tour. All right. Okay, once again, it's Warmac 357. This is the Evening Experience radio show from 5 to 7 every Thursday. It goes down. We here again. We lit like a Christmas tree. All right, so everybody that's getting ready to come in, once again, God rest the soul of Fred the Godson. God rest the soul of all the people who are dealing with COVID-19. And we're going to try to get Mr. James back momentarily. Oh, I appreciate it. All right, I'm going to wait for Mr. James to come back in. But once again, this is the opportunity that I give everybody to come on and see a great show, giving everybody an opportunity to facilitate learning more about the people who are out in the world who've done so many great things out in the industry, and give you an opportunity to see it from this perspective. All right, Mr. James is back in the building. We're gonna go back to him again. All right, bam, bam. All right, people, he is back momentarily. I can't see you at this moment.
Oh, wait a minute. Is it me? Wait a minute. Live. You still can't see me?
I'm gonna cancel you for a second. All right, Robert Parham stopped in. All right, so we should be able to grab him back again. Here we go. All right, he's back. Once again, it's WarMac 357. This is the Evening Experience Radio Show from 5 to 7 every Thursday. It's going down right here in the boudoir because of COVID-19. But I get the opportunity to speak with the illustrious, the incredible actor, professor, incredible person all around, Mr. Hawthorne James.
Yes, sir. Good to be here, bro.
With that being the case, name a film that you... are best known for that you would love to speak on and maybe give us some insight as to what was the process for you picking that particular film?
You know, people always say that films they like to forget. There's not one film I've ever done that I want to forget. They're all special to me in different ways. Five Heartbeats is the film that took me to a whole different level, of course. Speed is a film that did things for me on a different level. But the one film that I the most disappointed, well, there's another film. I'm not even gonna talk about this film that disappointed, because this is a recent film I did, and it's like, wow, did they screw this up? But before that, there was a film that was very disappointing to me. And that was a film I did with Alec Baldwin called Heaven's Prisoners. And we shot in New Orleans. And I read this script and I said to myself, I said, wow. And once again, I'm playing the lead bad guy. But it's Latino Creole guy who's the bad guy in the film. And so there's this one scene that Alec and I have this shootout, and he, of course, he shoots me and kills me, but I kill his wife in bed one night. He has a bait shot, and he's one of the boats gets loose, and he goes out, and I'm coming in to kill him, and he's gone, but I shotgun his wife. But on this phone conversation, I tell him, I'll kill you, I'll kill Baja Jolo, who passed away. Baja was his partner in the bait shop, and I'll kill that old black man, whatever. And so actually, people talk about this character all the way through the film, how bad he is, et cetera. And so we start shooting at each other in the laundry that I own. So we shoot at each other from the front door to the third floor. And we just blast each other. Well, once they edited the film, we start at the front, and then we cut to the third floor, and he shoots me. And then I fall through the thing. But the line that I really wanted to do was, once I'm on the ground, he leans into me and says, who did it? And I whispered to him, I said, Dieter. And he said, and he leans closer and said, what? I said, I did you. And I died. Well, what a great exit line. That was like, wow. You know, after you've been through the whole film and you see this guy just manipulating everything. Well, I go to do some ADR, some voice work on the film, and the director says to me when I walk in the studio, he says, don't be upset, man. We had to cut a lot of your stuff. And we had to cut specifically that last line of yours. And I said, why? What happened? What was the deal? He said, well, to be honest with you, you made Alex look like a punk, so we had to cut your stuff out.
All righty then.
So this is one of those things. I'm counting on this film to take me to another level. Alex got 10 films lined up to do, so this film is not his priority.
Right.
So because I did my job, I have to get cut out of the movie. But that's what's in Hollywood for you. You have to understand Hollywood. I've been cut out of a lot of movies, man, because I was better than. I tell you, no, you got me on the roll now. There was a movie I did with Linda Hamilton, the woman from Terminator. Did a film called Black Moon Rising.
Of course.
No, I just remember I was coming out of a studio and the director saw me. Said, you're the guy. You're the one I want. I want you. Blah 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 blah. So Linda Hamilton and I played people at a high-end party. And so one night we go out to the dealership and our posse steals Porsches and Mercedes and Rolls Royces, et cetera. So she and I are sitting in the front seat of the van after all the cars are gone, and we're just having a blast, just smiling and grinning because we done wrecked the night, you know what I'm saying? All day long, the director kept saying, don't be so sexual with each other. Don't be so sexual. Well, I don't know what that means. She looked at me, she didn't know what it meant. But that's all the direction we got all day long. So at the end of the day, when we were leaving, Linda came up to me, she said, I really like you, and I really hope we get to work with her. I've never seen her since then, and I've never worked with her before. But that was a great compliment from coming from a woman that was the star. So eventually I did see the film. And of course I got cut out the film. I'm not in the film anymore. And I realized what the director was doing. Tommy Lee Jones was love interest to Linda Hamilton.
Right.
If you watch the movie, they have no chemistry whatsoever. Nada, nada, zip, zip. The chemistry was between me and Linda.
Wow.
So who had to go?
You.
I had to go. That's Hollywood. You understand? Like I said, I've been cut out of a lot of stuff. I mean, TV shows. TV's the worst. I mean, if you get more laughs than the dog of the sitcom, you're gone. Your stuff is cut. You can't have it. The egos are incredible in Hollywood sometimes. Not all of them, but a whole bunch of them. And that's what you constantly deal with.
If you had some imparting words that you would want to give to the up-and-coming actors, what would it be?
Let nobody tell you no. Because people will discourage you. Because it's the crab in the barrel syndrome. I mean, eventually you'll find out whether you're good at it or not. I mean, especially if you do theater. If you know, when the audience doesn't respond to you or not, you'll learn. And you'll learn the hardest and can I deal with it? Because 90% of the people I started off with aren't in the business anymore. They just couldn't handle the ups and downs and the rejection. And they thought they were going to be a star tomorrow morning. And it doesn't happen that way. And I mean, from the very first audition I had in LA, I found that out. So it wasn't anything new to me. But for you, constantly, you have to be constantly working. It doesn't matter. People ask me all the time. Well, I tell them, I say, go to the university. There are student films being shot all the time. Go audition for those student films. If you're in college or something, or if there's a play, audition for the play. But if you're in somebody's film, Spielberg started somewhere. Who's the guy who did Raiders of the Lost Ark? What's his name? Spielberg's partner.
Harrison Ford?
No, not Harrison. No, the producer, director. Did the Star Wars movies.
Oh, notice when you ask something, that's when you forget, right? But it'll come to me in a second.
But those are people, I mean, they started as students. You never know. Who is it?
George Lucas.
They started as students. So you go into those students because you never know who's going to be the next Steven Spielberg. And they'll remember you from those days. And they'll remember your dedication in Hollywood. But you remember, Hollywood is about money. And once you get on the set, you can't afford to cost them money. I've seen people working in the morning time, break for lunch, come back from lunch, somebody else has got that role because that person wasn't able to handle it. Every time you screw up, you cost them money. And it doesn't even have to be your fault. I'm going to take one more quick story. I was doing an episode of ER. And I'm the kind of person, I don't believe in lateness. I believe in being early. So the night before, I had a flat tire in my car. Well, I changed the flat tire, and I'm on my way to work at Universal doing this episode of ER. And I had a flat tire. And, of course, I didn't have any, I didn't have a spare because I used it the night before. So I called the studio and asked them if they could come pick me up. I called AAA. They told my car to do this. I'm so early. I got on the set in makeup, in wardrobe, and I was 5 minutes late. Those people looked at me like I had eaten their last child. They were so angry they didn't know what to do. 5 minutes. That's how early I usually am. But it didn't matter. How dare this Negro make us wait? Wow. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
That's Hollywood. So don't, one thing you can be, I tell everybody, be on time, be early, study, constantly work at your craft, be pleasant on set. Don't because if you're not pleasant, people don't want to work with you. Your name better be Tom Cruise. You better, in order to be an asshole, you better be one of them people. Because if not, even you see how they did Roseanne. She was making a lot of money, but they hated her. That's what they eventually got rid of her. Because she's a miserable person. So, Hollywood is very, very small. Those executives talk to each other. Believe it. There is a list. So do your craft. Don't, and I started to say something that was stupid on my part. I say don't question. But I'm a boat rocker. Because I have a line. I don't use the N-word. It doesn't, I'm back in my 20s. I don't use it. My personal life or my professional life, and I've lost money and I've lost job because I don't use that word. And I don't put on a dress. That's my line. I'm not asking you to have my line, but I'm asking you to have a line. But my line is that. And it doesn't, you can't give me enough money to do that. There's not enough money in the world for me to do that because we only get 60, 70, 80 years on this planet. We have to stand for something. And if you don't, you're worthless. And money ain't, as much as I want my money, I want my money too, just like everybody else, but it doesn't rule my life. So those are the things I would tell young people. Work, study your craft, get better, be on time. But at the same time, you have to judge for yourself. You have to understand the consequences of when you say no. It's not just for that one time. There are consequences. But I say no in a heartbeat. I don't give a damn. Because I like me. Every time I go to the mirror and I look in the mirror, I say, I like that guy. And I feel good. So you make up your own mind, but we have to start saying no as a people. Otherwise, 200, 400 years ago, right, later down the line, we'll be looking in the mirror talking about, why are we not any better? You see what they're doing to you in China. You see what they're doing to you in Africa. And yet you wonder, and yet you fall for anything for $5? Come on, people, we got to do better.
Okay, so I have actor Mike Ray, who said Papa Cooley, very significant role in Polished Soul.
Oh, Mike. Is that Mike Ray? Let's see. Is that Mike Ray, the producer, director?
Yes.
Oh, Michael Ray Anderson was a producer film Polished Soul. And Mike's a really good guy. And I look forward to working with Mike again, hopefully soon. Because he listens, he's smart, and he did everything. He did the cinematography, he wrote the script, it's coming out of his pocket with helping his people. But yeah, Mike's good people. 17 and a half years, I can't imagine seeing 17 and a half years in the joint, man. Thank God. But I'm very happy for Mike that he's out and he's doing what he needs to do to change the world. He's another one of the people that were working to change the world, not just put money in his pocket. And once again, go back to Why Me. Robert Parham did a hell of a job directing that movie. And all the people involved. That little girl, I can't wait till y'all know her name. She's going to be major. She's had her own TV show since she was, 9, 10, and we're doing one of those local talk shows. And she does everything. She's a smart little whippersnapper. I love it. Well, God bless. Why Me the Movie?
Why Me the Movie is getting ready to come out. Robert Parham, 5-time world champion, former kickboxer, incredible actor who's done a few different films. He did one with Fred the Hammer Williamson, and now he's with the illustrious one and only Mr. Hawthorne James. And there's a few more movies that he's getting ready to put out. And I appreciate you taking, once again, time out of your schedule to sit with us today. Appreciate you taking the opportunity to give me to listen to the stories and the wisdom that you've passed down through this interview. And I look forward to talking with you in the future, and maybe we can get a film going or something.
I'm down with that, bro. I'm definitely down with that.
And tell us we are here, so please take the opportunity to come on to this show. We are here. We are definitely trying to do big things and make stuff happen. I believe there's a question for you here. In one of the responses, is there one particular role you have played that really touched you personally?
Well, okay. Why me? That's the first thing that comes to my mind. I'm trying to think of something else that would have touched me. And I think, and I'm trying to understand what the questioner means by that. But why me touched me?
Played that literally... It showed maybe a piece of your life or something that you've been through or something that you know somebody else has been through that you said, whoa, this is something that I can align with or I felt because I've been through this.
Honestly, it's like everything that I've ever done has been pulled from little bits and pieces of different areas of my life. So it's always a little bit of me in there somewhere. But I can't say that. I mean, why? I have to go back to Why Me and Polished Soul, because those are really touching to me. The rest of them, I love doing it. It's fascinating for me to try to understand what is it about Big Red that grabs people. It's like this guy was cutthroat. But one woman said to me, she said, she likes Big Red because he was a businessman back in the 50s. And I said, oh, I never even thought about that. It's true. And then Robert allowed me to play. Robert during that film was a director of, was an actor's director, because some of that stuff came from Shakespeare. That funeral scene, that's Shakespeare. That's what I brought back from London through a play, Richard III. How much time we have, but let me see if I can get through this story real quick. When I went to London and studied, I fell in love with Richard III, who's a hunchback cripple who kills the king, his cousin, and then at the funeral, he woos Lady Anne, the king's wife, over the casket, and she becomes his queen. Well, this is a fascinating play to me. So in Five Heartbeats, my backstory is, and this is not in the script, this is just something I did research for myself as an actor, putting little pieces together for myself. I'm so mad at Jimmy because Eleanor originally was mine. He stole her from me. That's why I'm always angry with him. Now this is not in the script. This is something I do as, you know, preparing myself as an actor for to make decisions about how to do things in the film. So I wasn't in the funeral scene. And I went to Robert during rehearsal. I said, Robert, I need to be in the funeral scene. And he said, yeah, you do. So he never wrote anything for me. We shot when Jimmy comes to my house in the morning, we shot that in the morning. And then we were gonna shoot the funeral scene that afternoon. Well, on the ride back to the church from after we shot that morning at the house, the night before I had written this speech out. And I'm sitting in the front seat, in the passenger seat, with this speech right behind me, the producer sitting on that side. And I'm thinking to myself, I don't know Robert that well. I said, hell with it. Hey, Robert, this is what I think I need to say at the funeral scene. So I handed it back to him, right? He read it. He said, yeah, that's good. And he just, all he did was edit it. Because me as an actor, I must have wrote a whole page of this stuff. But he just took it and he wrote it. So what you see is what I wrote. And that's direct from Shakespeare. So you study. You not only study you study the world. It's like I'm studying you right now. Who knows what little piece that I see of you will wind up in a film one day? I study people when I walk down the street, the mannerisms, the smile, the laughs. And that's one thing I hope. I hope and pray that not in one of the roles you ever see me in is the same as what you've ever seen in something else. That's what I work really, really hard to make sure that everyone, when I was an extra, and I did extra work, about five or six of them, I remember I did a film called A Hero Ain't Nothing But a Sandwich, and I'm walking down the street. Well, way off in the distance, you can see me, I got a limp going, because I'm developing a character for an extra. Because that's the way my mind works. Every extra role I've ever done, I developed a character for that extra role. Young people, work, observe the world, read. So you can pull things from not only your life, but from other people's life to make the character come alive. Have fun. That's what I do. I tell everybody in a heartbeat, I play for a living. I have fun every day I work, every time I walk on the stage, every time I walk on the set. And then to be do films that mean something. I mean, I've got a couple. This is what I'm gonna plug this. There's two films on the internet that I produced and directed. One is called Remember Me with a question mark, and the other is called Lisa Trotter. So those two short films on YouTube. And another film that I'm a plug right now is a film called The Stick Up Kids. I directed it and I had a lot of input into the script. We shot in New York, but I'm very proud of that film. And coming back to asking, to answering the question of the young lady, I forgot about that film. I love that film because that's my heart in there. That's me talking in there. Because I wrote a lot of that of me in the Stick Up Kids. Tariq Alexander, producer, star in it. And he gave me, I had done a film called The System Within with Tariq. in which I was working with the actors. He asked me to work with the actors. And then when he got the money to do the Stick Up Kids, he said, by the way, you know you're directing. I said, boom, 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 boom. But then realizing that I had been working with the best directors in the world. I'm only one of the only actors in the world that have been in two Steven Spielberg movies. Worked with Oliver Stone, of which I got cut out, but that's a whole different thing. You can see my back in the movie. But working with Robert Townsend and Keenan Ivory Wayans, watching these great directors, and I never sit in my trailer. Once I get my makeup and wardrobe on, I'm out walking around that set all day long, watching everything. I watch the gaffers, I watch the electricians, I watch the DP and his crew. Watch, and learn. So once I got a chance to direct, I remember the first day on the set, I went to Tariq and I said, Tariq, I think, what do you think we ought to? He looked at me, he said, I hired you. Go do your job. He had my back. He never questioned the thing that I did. And then from that moment on, I realized I know what I'm doing. And I had a blast directing. And that character that I portrayed in there, the stick-up kids, that's near and dear to my heart. He gets killed in the movie for different reasons. But if you get it, let me recommend some films that you may not have seen. The Stick Up Kids is a full-length feature. It's available. You can download it. On YouTube, you have Remember Me with a Question Mark by two sisters. And I lost $1 million because I said no to the studio. Because I wrote this film as a play for two great actresses that I knew. And then I wrote the film. So the Warner Brothers and 20th Century Fox wanted to buy it. But it's by two black women. And they came back to me and said, both of them said, do you think that the women can be white? I said, give my damn script back. Because they couldn't believe that two black women were ambitious, were middle class, upwardly mobile. That's not in their mindset to believe that. But I'm not sure. And they offered me closer to $999,000, something like that. And I said, no. I didn't write this for white women. I wrote this for my sisters. So I put my money where my mouth is. I don't just talk that talk. And I've turned down other stuff. So, but see, Remember Me, with Question Mark, and Lisa Trotter. Those are two on YouTube, and the Stick Up Kids. Those are films that you may not have seen.
All right, so I'm gonna give you this last question from one of the guests who's online. They said, when you draw from a dramatic scene, where do you draw from?
Oh, it starts with the script. It has to be on the script. It has to be on that page first. And then you just start building a character. I tell people all the time, I say, what did that character have for breakfast? And it may sound stupid to say things like that. Well, you never see that character eat. No, your attitude is, personally, when you don't eat in the morning, by 2 o'clock in the afternoon, how do you feel?
Listen.
But when you eat a whole full meal in the morning, 2 o'clock in the afternoon, how do you feel? So it's those decisions that you make. That's how you draw. That's how you build a character. You build it piece by piece by piece by piece. The film that I did with Tariq called The System Within. That character didn't come to me till the day before we started shooting, because I had a driver that was Jamaican. And he was driving me for 2 weeks. I was in New York. And all of a sudden I realized, whoa, this character is Jamaican. So the character became a Jamaican. How are you going to come up with that inspiration? And you have to keep working and working until you finally discover it. It's like I did a film with a guy named I did a film with a guy. Oh, we'll be back.
Yes.
Okay. I did a film with called Abandoned Act with Sabir Bey. Now I brought Sabir on because Sabir is a scholar in history with the Moors, etc. And the law. He's a scholar in that. And so when I had the opportunity, I wanted him to put some knowledge into that film. It's a short film. It's, once again, I think it's available. It's called Abandoned Act. But we showed stuff about the Moors. And the character that I'm playing is a prisoner. And he's left his daughter, and he's been in and out of jail. And finally, he realizes, I've been screwed up all my life. I'm trying to reconnect with my daughter again. And Sabir plays a character who is a youngster who has been feeding me knowledge. That's a great film. I mean, if you want to see that one, see that one. But I brought Sabir in because he has that knowledge about the Moors. And I wanted to talk about the Moors just a little bit. I don't believe in banging people over the head. But if I can feed you just a little bit of knowledge in everything that I do, then that's great for me.
Once again, folks, I just want to thank the illustrious, once again, incredible actor, Hawthorne James, who took the opportunity to be here today with us, to drop those jewels, to give us a perspective, to give us an opportunity to see his works. If you haven't seen them, and if you have, just go back and revisit. Take the opportunity to learn something and do something great. And I appreciate you being here today with us. If you're not following him, it's Hawthorne James 9225.
2995.
Oh, 22?
Yeah, on Instagram it's Hawthorne James 2995.
2995. Hawthorne James 2995. Yeah. Do you have any other that you work out of?
I do the Twitter, but I very rarely go on Twitter. But on my Facebook page, it's just Hawthorne James. Hawthorne James.
Perfect.
I don't have a web page anymore. So
follow him. Watch out for the great movies that have happened and will happen. And
yes,
appreciate you being here today. And once again, I thank you for being a guest.
I really appreciate you, bro. I really appreciate you.
No problem, sir. All right. Okay. And then we're going to talk behind the scenes because I want Robert, Mr. Townsend himself, I want to definitely get into the mindset of speaking with him or anybody that you can send our way. We'd be greatly appreciate it.
Absolutely. Oh, and by the way, today's the Robert's documentary called The Making the Five Heartbeats started streaming. It's on Amazon, all kinds of places. It's called Making the Five Heartbeats. And it is fascinating, man, the things that he went through to get that film made. So Making the Five Heartbeats is another one of those things I recommend people just look up.
All right. Appreciate you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. All righty. Give me a buzz, bro.
Definitely.
All right.
All right. That was the one and only, I'm going to say this again, one and only Hawthorne James. And we're bringing in our next guest, Mr. I Am Stunt. Hopefully he's still there because we definitely going to talk with him about his music and the different things he got going on. Mr. Stunt, what's up, sir?
What's going on, man?
How you doing?
All right, yourself?
Can't thank you for keeping you waiting, but, you know, when you get those incredible, incredible actors and people who we definitely try to keep them talking about.
I hear you, man.
So first and foremost, how did you get your name?
Well, man, when I was younger, I used to hang around with a lot of cats. I used to come dressed in flashy all the time, right? So they'd be like, what's up, Stunner Boy, you know? And I'm from Oakland. Everybody's known as the East Oakland Stunner Boy out there, you know? So, you know, that they just started calling me that from Stunner Boy. It just became Stunner. And then from Stunner, just stayed short Stunt, you know? S-T-U-N-T. That's it. Yeah, man.
With that being the case, what got you into R&B?
Well, man, honestly, when I was a kid, my mama used to play music, cleaning the house and all that, right? I had this little toy piano, and she heard me following along with it. She was like, oh, man, I got to get this boy a real piano, right? She got me a little real piano, and I just started messing around. I didn't really take it serious till, like, about 3 years ago or something like that. So, yeah, I started getting into R&B. I like the smooth, you know, smooth rhythm and all. I like all types of music, but R&B gets me, you know?
All right. What was the now, where do you get your inspiration from for the music that you put out?
Well, I'm from the Bay Area, so I try to put a little twist to it. You know, I grew up slapping Too Short, Kick the Sneak, E-40 and all of that, you know? So, you know, I try to blend in R&B with the, you know, with the Bay vibe, which I, why I call it R&B, you feel me? So okay. I try to mix that in there, make it a vibe, you feel me?
Where are you originally from?
I'm from Oakland, California, born and raised, you feel me?
Okay, Oakland. Oh, okay. You and MC Hammer.
Actually, he stayed down the street by me a couple times over there on 69th.
That's what's up.
He used to stay on Haven Square right there. I've seen him a couple times.
So now, music in and of itself, your inspirations, does it come from real life or things that you've been through or things that you've come through?
Honestly, man, I like music itself, and it just comes natural. So it just, you know, when I make music, a lot of times it's no meaning to it. It's just how I feel, and it's just, I feel in the moment. I'm making a beat. I start with the beat, right? Okay, I'm feeling it. Okay, I just come up with some lyrics to it. Ooh, okay, I'm feeling this, and then I just start going vibing with it. You feel me? It just starts clicking, falling into place on its own. So I haven't made really nothing yet that really means a lot to me yet, but I will. You know, I got a lot in mind, but. Right now, I'm just making filter music.
Well, the reason why I asked is because we're going to get ready to play your song and debut it for the people here. One of the joints that was sent to me is called Drunk Text. And the reason why I asked was this been through is because, you know, sometimes after the alcohol is in, you get a little bit brave and you say certain.
Yeah, I mean, you know. It could, a lot of people could relate it to that, man. You know, okay. A lot of people could relate. So I made it relatable. But yeah.
That's definitely what's up. All right, people. So I want y'all to listen to I Am Stunt. This joint right now, you can cop it because it's currently out. Yep. It's called Drunk Text. I want you to listen to this. This is the one and only I Am Stunt. Let's go.
Yeah, let's get it. It's a liquid courage. Yeah.
One and only, I'm gonna say it again. I am stunned. He's stunned.
It's a vibe. Hey.
All right. I can definitely say that you are definitely a one that deals with sounds that resonate with people. You definitely give power to music itself, because I think everybody in here who listened to it just now was like, yo, fire. Definitely bring the heat for what you're putting out.
On top.
The official Patience J for bringing you to the evening experience. I appreciate her.
Man. Much love to her, man.
Big shouts out to them. Y'all do incredible work, and you definitely have an incredible artist here. What's the things that we have to look forward to going further into 2020?
Well, man, I ain't trying to say too much, but definitely be out on the lookout, man. I'm going to surprise y'all with a lot of stuff, man. So, you know, follow, get up in there, and get involved, man. You're going to get it.
Okay.
A lot of stuff coming, man.
Now, what's the name of the current EP? Do you have?
I'm sorry. What was that?
What was the name of the current EP?
Well, I'm just dropping singles right now. I haven't dropped the whole EP yet, but I'm just dropping singles, and I'm just throwing it all out there for y'all. You feel me?
It's
available everywhere. You feel me? Amazon, Apple Music, iTunes, Spotify, everywhere. You know, you can search it up anywhere. It's all out there, though. What's that?
Is there an EP coming?
We might do that. But right now, man, I'm just, you know, throwing singles out there, making some feel-good music, you know, one at a time. But we might do a little EP sooner or later. It's going to happen. It's going to come along.
All right.
For sure.
So if you had to drop something on an up-and-coming artist as far as a jewel, what would that be?
As in what, man?
Anything that you would say to them as they're coming into this business, what would you say to an up-and-coming artist themselves?
Well, I mean, don't give up, man. Just keep going. You know, it's rough, man. You know, I've been having times where I want to quit, but it's just like, man, if it's your passion, it's your love, man, might as well just keep going. And, man, you're never going to know until, you know, you're never going to know if you don't try. So.
That's true.
You know, just keep your head up, man. Keep pushing. If it's your dream, go for it. You know, if it's your passion, just keep going with it. But don't see it as a job, but don't see it as a, man, you know, like it's a bunch of work. Just have fun with it, man. Enjoy it. And that's, as long as you're enjoying it, you ain't going to stress about it, man. You know, it's going to be good.
All right. Thank you for taking time out of your schedule. Thank you for taking the opportunity to interview with us, and we appreciate you coming through. Tell everybody where they can find you on.
No, thank you, man. Thank you. I appreciate you, man. You can find me on Instagram, Twitter as well. I am Stunt Oren Bay, and Spotify, iTunes, all that. I am Stunt. So, yeah, I'm on there. Holla at me. It's good.
All right. Appreciate you, man. Bro.
Much love.
All right, so that was the one and only I Am Stunt. We appreciate him taking time out of his busy schedule for taking the opportunity to speak with us, dropped a few jewels on people. If it's your passion, just know that you got to stick with it. It's not going to come easy. It's not going to be you know, it's like a relationship. It's like a dance. It's something that you got to do. Make sure you take the opportunity to make that type of stuff happen. Now, I see somebody else. AB. Okay. He was here for 2 seconds. Big shout out to everybody that is wanting to be a part of this show and that listens every week. Like I said, I work hard and I'm trying to bring you all great content and give you all great stuff to look at. I appreciate the official Patience Jay, the gorgeous, beautiful, vivacious Patience Jay. I want to thank everybody who tuned in today. I want to thank everybody who watches every week. I want to thank everybody who definitely, you know, looks out for this show and that listens to us and that watches us on a regular basis. Tell a friend, tell a mother, tell a brother, tell another. If you have anybody that you would like to have on the show, please contact me. We'll definitely take the opportunity and get some of your guests on. Now, I'm not going to bring everybody. I'm not going to let you know that up front. But I will definitely try to get y'all, you know, to be here, to be a part of the greatness that's happening. We got a few things more we're going to be talking about next week. We have incredible guests and people who are definitely wanting to be a part of this show. A.B. Butler, we're going to get him on real quick, give him an opportunity to talk. Appreciate everybody tuning in every week and making a connection with us. But we definitely try to have everybody on. A.B. Butler, if you don't know, is definitely an incredible manager, incredible person as far as our music itself, and is definitely one you can hang your hat on. One night, he showed up to the studio and brought in Rick James's brother, and we had an incredible interview. Last week was Dragon, and I appreciate any and everything that he does as far as being this person.
What's up? What's up, young man? I just want to, you know, get on here with you, man. Shout out Fred the Godson, just passed away, man.
Yes, sir.
Sad situation, man. Sad situation, man. You know what I mean? Everybody out there, don't believe nothing your government said. Do not rush out there to go and feel that you want your groove back. Stay in your cell. Stay in your block. You know what I mean? Just wait till they find something to kill this ghost. Because right now, it's nothing but a ghost, but it's killing us blacks left and right.
I tell everybody the same thing. Just from the perspective that you got to understand that it in and of itself is not going to go away. It's not something that is something that not, oh, this is made up. No, it is. This is something that is something that you have to deal with, that you have to understand it alive. It is killing people off. And there's a lot of people who are fallout. God rest the soul of Fred the Godson, one of our prolific rappers in the BX, who definitely took it to a whole nother level. And I definitely want to tell everybody that you have to, you know, give people their flowers while they're alive. And that's why I talk to my brother AB. That's why I talk to a lot of people, because I want them to understand you mean something before you pass, and I don't get the opportunity to say.
Oh, yeah. You know, and then, you know, like I said, I got to tell people, man, it's sad. God is just tired of what's going on this earth, man. You know what I mean? It's just he tired of the people. Some, you know, our fake industry cats. He tired of everything right now. And the best thing for you to do is, like, you know, you don't do it now, you should have been doing it, you know, pray or whatever. But at the end of the day, man, you got to clean your house out, man, you know, and you got to clean the selfish out. You got to clean out everything, man. You got to open your eyes to this, what's going on, you know what I mean?
Big time. But what the other thing is that I want people to understand is that life in and of itself means more than what people think it does sometimes. And that they should understand that life is about more than what people perceive it to be. It's precious. It can be taken at any moment. So what you do with it while you're here makes a difference of how you go further in life and where you go with it in life. But I also want to say, this, you know, God rest the soul of Don Solo, Soulful Journey brand. He was another rapper as well as business person, had a radio show as well, passed away not too long ago.
Good dude.
So I'm going to get ready to shut this show now. But I want to tell you, I appreciate everything that you're doing. I appreciate everybody dropping in every week. And I appreciate all the stuff that y'all bring to this platform. And let's keep it going. Once again, this is the Evening Experience Radio Show, 5 to 7 every Thursday. It goes down right here, for right now, on Instagram. But we're definitely going to have more stuff coming.
You know, definitely. Shout out to Fred the Godson. He was a real person. I'm not gonna say an industry cat or whatever. Fred was a real dude, man. You know what I mean? It wasn't nothing phony about them. And then on top of that, before you go, man, I got this GoFundMe page where I'm giving back to the artists, to the people that work around these artists that these artists forget about. You know what I mean? The freelancers. You know, so I'm just trying to raise that. You know, if you go to my Facebook page and my Instagram, you'll see it up there. AB Butler 914. My Facebook page is AB Butler. You know, I'm just trying to help to give back. You know what I mean? Because we work hard around these artists so much, and then something left go wrong, they ready to leave off the ship. So, you know, just trying to help give back to the people, man, you know.
All right. And big shout right. out to Darren Henson. If you didn't know, he has many platinum plaques and gold plaques. He's a choreographer, actor, an incredible actor. You've seen him in Soul Food. You've seen him in Stump the Yard. You've seen him in 1001 films, being an incredible actor. Extending a prayer and blessings and healing on the families have been directly affected. We pray that they receive comfort that is needed in this time. And so it is. Shout out to DJ Self. He popped in earlier. Shout out to all the people who've been popping in and out of the show. I appreciate y'all, you know, coming in and sharing your point of views and sharing your time with us. Once again, this is the Evening Experience. I'm going to holler at y'all next week. I appreciate y'all taking the time. God bless. And I will talk with you soon.
All right, home. Peace.
Peace out, brother. All right, people, we're getting ready to shut this down. If anybody wants to come on real quick, before I shut this down, let me know. We definitely had an incredible time talking to y'all, speaking with y'all, and, you know, getting real perspectives of people who are being affected by COVID, people who are, you know, dealing with, you know, family plight and all these different things that are going on because of what's happening out there in the world. Take the opportunity, care about somebody, love somebody, and be great with them. Peace.